Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organizations. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of His eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we have established various branch schools throughout the United States and various parts of the world. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original names and title of our Father and Word or Son and Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of the physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means Elohim is a title our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by the letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the Hebrew English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, and limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of the chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in His pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right from within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form could only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this selfsame spirit manifested Himself in the physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah.
Whom the
whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. The simple yet intelligent question that we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Messiah, of the Savior, during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further investigation of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by a divine pattern of the universe. Divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of the most holy place, the holy place, and the court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle, and the absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Our primary constitutional aims and objectives of this institute are as follows. First, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and as he actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexpected spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, to extirpate current superstitions, skepticisms, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons of children of Yahweh. Ninth, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. Tenth, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah, with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. This morning we'll have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. And following the prayer, we'll have a selection of music. And for the scripture lesson, it will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser, 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter.
Good morning. It's time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for allow us to be here this morning to learn about your purpose and plan of salvation. We are so happy to be here, and I hope you keep feeding us with beautiful things you reveal for whoever is in the speaker in the morning. I say all those things in your only sign name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
Oh, put it in the ground. Death is the state of its condition. Then you see it come to fruition. That's a type of resurrection. When you turn off the light and go to sleep at night, bury your head beneath the covers. Arise in the morning, oh, that's just another type of resurrection. So I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives, I know. Tell me, do you? Yes, I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives, I know. He gave me all the proof. Yes, I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives, this I know. How about you? How about you? Israel ate that lamb, then left Egypt's land to the Red Sea, old Pharaoh right behind them. Through divided waters, Yah delivered them on dry land. That's a type of resurrection. Old Joseph was a dreamer, his brothers did despise. They put him in that hole, for they sought to take his life. Then he was lifted up by the merchants passing by. That's a type of resurrection. So I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives, this I know. Tell me, do you? Yes, I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives, oh, he lives. He gave me all the proof. Yes, I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives, this I know. How about you? How about you? Abraham was faithful, took his son to sacrifice. Then Yahweh said, you please me, you don't have to take his life. Then he turned around to see the ram Yah did provide. That's a type of resurrection. Oh, a type of resurrection. Oh, 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 oh. Now all these types and shadows truly testify that Yahshua has risen, that Holy Spirit that gives life. I don't have to sit and wonder if he is alive. 'Cause he said, I am the resurrection. I am the resurrection. So I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives, I know, do you know? Yes, I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives, I know, do you know?
Good morning, class. Our scripture lesson will be taken from 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, page 240, and I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts revised by the late A.B. Trainum. 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, page 240. Therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of Yahweh deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of Elohim. But if our evangel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the spirit of this age has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious evangel of the Messiah, who is the image of Yahweh, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but the Messiah, Yahshua the Messiah, and ourselves your servant for Yahshua's sake. For Yahweh, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of Yahweh in the face of Yahshua the Messiah. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of Yahweh and not of us. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of Yahshua, that the life also of Yahshua might be made manifest in our body. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Yahshua's sake, that the life also of Yahshua might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So then death worketh in us, but life in you. We, having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believed, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore speak, knowing this, that he which raised up Yahshua shall raise up us also by Yahshua, and shall present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundance grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of Yahweh, for which cause we faint not, but through our outward man perish, though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, which we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. I have read 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Morning. Good morning. Okay, so does anyone want to give a testimony or have anything to say for this morning?
Give me something to hold on to. Good morning. It's on. Yes, here we go. I walked into class. It's good morning class, everybody out there. I walked into class today, not expecting to be a speaker. However, what was said this morning was so appropriate to how I was feeling and what made me come on into class today. Today is my first day, don't have to work, so oh my gosh, I couldn't wait to get to class. So, my thoughts was, before I came here, I should be in class all the time. And there's a reason why. Well, no, first I ask myself, why do we have to read this Bible every day? Why is it necessary that we study all the time the charts, the patterns, the step to the most holy place, what's in the holy place, how it relates to our body, you know, the pattern of Moses, how it was told to us. If you don't go every day, you don't forget that stuff. If you don't go every day, you're not reminded how holy and how valuable life is. If you're not in class every day, you don't keep it abreast at the first at the heart of things, in the forefront of things, because as the lesson was saying today, you have this inner being, which is a spirit thing, and then you have this outer temporal body. When you're not in class, what are you focused on? The outer temporal body. Oh my gosh. So because that's, you know, at the time, that's what's important. At the moment, that's what's important. But eternally, spiritually, there's always the struggle between inner man and outer man to be better than what they are, to be better and to achieve higher things, which is finding out about ourselves, finding out about our Creator, knowing who we are essentially and where we're going. That we can be in this world day to day, playing around, having fun, transgressing all the sins, whatever, blah, 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 because that's what the body does. And then what happens to the body? You know, we know how the body works. We've seen it firsthand. What we feed our mind goes into our lungs, heart, body, and everything else comes out. But there's a pattern to this. And if we don't keep with the pattern, what happens to the body? Decline. We're getting older anyway because the body is temporal, right? We only have a certain amount of time anyway, you know, to be here, to enjoy all these temporal things. However, if the soul, if the spirit is not fulfilled, it's even harder to enjoy the temporal things. Honestly, it is. For me. I don't know if everybody feels like I feel, but, you know, I'm in the world. I'm out there. I'm enjoying, you know, eating, food, drink, you know what I'm saying, the whole things. And who provided all that for me? Where did it all come from? I'm eating, drinking, having fun, not even thinking about where it came from. Who supplied me with all these temporal things? Everything was provided in the beginning. You know what I'm saying? And whether or not we partake or not partake, or how much we partake of life and its indulgences. And in the end, we will find out if we're not taking care of ourselves, what happens, how the body itself will decline. In addition to the fact that we're only going to be here in a space of time, for a period of time anyway. And we speed the process up with our carnality for the most part. So I'm glad to be a part of class. I'm glad to be here every chance I get. It does bring to the forefront to my mind that there is more to life than the body. There's more to life and living than having fun and enjoying it without. Everything comes with a cost. You know what I'm saying? I don't know. Maybe that's the wrong place to put it, but everything comes with a cost. You can have fun, but what are you going to pay for it? What are you going to pay for your soul to be redeemed, to go back and be one with the Father? Because that's where you're going to go. I mean, the other consequences are. They are that. And with that, that was basically my thought. And I'm glad they'd be able to express it to y'all. And with that, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Okay, is there anyone else that would like to give a testimony or a lecture? Oh, Dr. Eunice Reiser.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
I really enjoyed what you had to say, Sharon. You brought up some good points, things that I would say Yahweh is just putting on not just your heart and mind, but mine too. And about the pattern and about studying. And if you don't use it, you'll lose it. And I guess this may be a cleanup time or whatever, but I've had to do a recheck with myself. And Yahweh has given us so much that, like you were saying, no one else is going to stand before the Father but you yourself alone. I can't go into heaven, if you want to say it that way, for no one else. And then if you know where heaven is, that's absolutely true. Mm-hmm. You know. So I've had a lot of thoughts going on, and if you want to say, be put in check, like, what do you know? Why you don't know? What is the purpose of reading? What is the purpose of studying? What do you study? Then it's all about learning. Yahweh's name alone is a beginning of a knowledge that I did not have in the very beginning. Yahweh did take me back to look when I came into this class. And he showed me some things that I had wrong and the way that I was brought up. Now, it's nothing against where I came from. Nothing, not at all, because now I can see it, Yahweh's purpose, totally. But at first, I had missed it, clear clipping. But it was perfectly set. But I had it backwards, if I can say what was going, the way that I was taught, the way that I listened, the way that I learned. I've had to take that and look at the fact of where I am now. And I can say truly now, since being in Ontario, that I have come into a good foundation. I didn't have one before. And, oh man, I don't even know whether or not how to really put it. But I saw something on how I was brought in, how I didn't have the straight of it. Now, this teaching is all, Yahweh gave Dr. Kinley a divine vision and revelation. And he so loved us. And Yahweh told him, or he responded back to Yahweh, what he was going to do with what he was given. And he said, teach your people. Well, right off the bat, Yahweh had already, I mean, from the foundation, the way he has set things up from the angelic. In fact, this all is in the realm of eternity. But we are given the opportunity now to learn, to really learn and know Yahweh as he really is and actually exists, because he gave it to us. And the majority of the world, they don't even have a clue. That lets me see how blessed, and I should be humble every moment for the simple reason at one time, and I'm just going to say as of late, I did not see the process clearly. Everybody, we all going to have to go. You cannot get around going through the process that Yahweh has set up for us to learn about him, his son. You are definitely right. Sit in class. Listen. Open up our hearts and mind. And please do not think that you know it. That is where we can get totally messed up, miss it, clear clipping. My mistake. Carrying something from here and trying to drag it over in this age. It don't work. This is why it is good to know what these ages and dispensations is all about. See, this Old Testament here, that's where it was over here, and it's supposed to stay over here. Now, Yahshua, this carnal ordinances chart, Now, yesterday, Yahweh had me to place this bad boy on myself. How many of, you know, take a look at yourself, really. That's what he said. Take a look at yourself. Watch the things that you do or have done. Go back and rehearse. The circumcision, the ceremonies, the baptism. No, it's not like they did it back here. But you take these same principles. And when we look at it, I was reading, I think it was yesterday. This is beautiful how Yahweh has taken everything, placed it here for we are to learn about him, Yahshua. Why did he come in and beautifully to confirm who brought about all of it for a reason? This circumcision, they were talking about how the fetus, about a fetus being born, a fetus has to break through that membrane. And that's like circumcising, that is uncovering for that baby to come out. It's like the ceremonies. When this baby is in the womb, it is bowed down, its head and his knees in reverence. They have ceremonies now that they give reverence to whomever, whatever God that they are. The baby is already, it's baptized in the fluid before. See, this is Yahweh spirit law operating that fetus. But he has taken that manifestation and put forth what he had set up way back then to show us now that it is not by man's hand. It is not by any law. It's spirit law that is now in operation. And we are to take the things that we do that Yahweh has us to manifest and look at what it is pointing up, not about you. Show for in him that he is manifesting in you. But the principle, irregardless of whether or not you look at it for what it is, call a spade a spade. You know, if you've been disobedient, if you've been a jerk, if you have been a goodly child, whatever the case may be, it's not because of you. He's showing that Moses was considered a goodly child. These children down here, this was a peculiar people. Yahweh chose them out. Just like he chose us. We don't. Dr. Love said something the other night, a couple of things that he said, which I got it, and it was cool. We were talking about things that was in the scriptures. I don't know whether or not it was Ephesians or where, what Saul was talking about. We have to remember, and no, it was Mark in the, what do you call the Gospels. The things that they were writing about, they were writing about something that happened here. It's not like they were here writing all about it. They got this through being a companion, being a physician, you know, they wrote that, but this is all happening over here in this age. This is rightly dividing the word of truth, knowing, you know, where these ages, I appreciate that very much. That was good. Then he also brought, it was a ding ding, that it's not the thing that has the power, but it's what you got on your mind about the thing. Because if you don't have anything on your mind about it, the thing cannot affect you. So I took all of that. That was like, well. And just took it to heart. And from that point, it was like, that is so true. It is so true. Yahweh, he gave us a pattern. And the pattern is simply 1, 2, 3. Most holy place, court roundabout. He has given all kinds of examples. All of this was set up for us. So in this day, we are seeing and doing the self same thing. But we have to look, I have to look for the principle of these manifestations, not the thing, but the principle of the thought of Yahweh having, he has set Moses up. There was nothing great about Moses, but what Yahweh has set him up for. Going through this darkness that was down here, Yahweh was down there too. Joshua, the son of Nun, he was down there. They went through these 10 plagues. Three of them they didn't have to go. Three of them they went through, but the others they didn't. But the children had light in their dwelling. Where was that light coming from? It wasn't coming from the regular sun. That was Joshua. Joshua down there was that light that he was providing for them. Just like going through the Red Sea. Joshua, they say the cloud, they went through the cloud. And it was a pillar of fire by night and a cloud by day. And the cloud led them. And when they saw that Pharaoh was behind, this cloud went behind them. Who was that cloud? Who was that light? That was Joshua. See, it's like Joshua has been doing this all along, has been here. He was Moses' minister. The scripture that Joshua said that he didn't come to be ministered unto, but to minister. Same with Joshua. Being who he is, I mean, why would he be in the, sort of like the background and Moses is the one that looked like is doing all the work? He did, just like Dr. Kinley said, he didn't want no great accolades. He didn't want to be looking like, you know, he has some great name or what. Don't look at me. The same thing. You wouldn't have never, I mean, in fact, Christendom probably still don't know who Joshua is. That is a mystery unto them. They don't know that this was the Messiah, Joshua, manifesting. He's been manifesting all the way through this creation because he came in. It was instituted. Coming down, where is it? When he, Elohim, breathed the breath of life into Adam, Yahweh manifesting in the flesh, and Adam all died. This is where mankind come from. And he still, even with Noah, Abraham, all of those were set up as types and shadows. He used those vessels to get the point across that we now, in this day, we can now be a witness and see that he set every single thing up. Only 8 were to be saved in the ark. All these things are significant. The 120 years he preached. Well, we shouldn't be all upset if we're sitting in here 50 and 40, 70 years and listening to God. He preached for 120 years. There was a reason that this blood is down here. It was on their head. There's a reason to show the unerring accuracy to be proven to us and anybody else. Yahweh said it, that blood, water, spirit, 40. And we can go through with the blood, water, spirit, 40, the death, burial, the resurrection. This is what is being acclimated and put into practice with myself. When it is said, go according to the pattern, Eunice, that is exactly what I mean. I have given you the pattern. I have told you blood, water, spirit, 40. The simplicity. Death, burial, resurrection. We can see it going back here. Moses, you know what? I know people have a problem with Moses and talking about Moses, but we can't do nothing but talk about the self same thing, because this is what Yahweh has given us all, this tool to learn and know about him. So we're going to go back to Moses. We're going to use what he has set down here, that starting with Abraham, the promise of Abraham. Abraham, he gave Abraham the promise. But he told Abraham, he said, but first you must go down. Well, he caused the famine to happen, that they had to go down. And this is where the Israelites, they were down here. But Yahweh is setting it up, because in the same token, Joseph had to be, was sold down into Egypt. But he became, pretty, second-hand. Yeah, he was a right-hand man to Pharaoh. So he had privy to the things that the people were going to need. So when they came down, it was already there set for them, but they had to go through some rough and rigorous stuff. But this is Yahweh showing himself. I will be what I will to be, but you are going to be my peculiar people that I'm going to use, showing forth my purpose. And the same, like I say, we can take this off of the chart. And that's the same thing with us. Yahweh has caused us, and this is to believe the report, to understand it, and that report will become a part, if I can say a part of you, but really what it all comes down, we are the body. If we know who Yahshua is, that he's the one that came in, he did all of this, went through all of it for our soul's salvation's sake. Because I didn't know nothing. I didn't even have a clue that my soul need to be saved, let alone from what. So that is the look that I have been in. And I want to read. Whether or not I have the best memory or not, that's not the point. It is to learn in this day everything, because now I can understand the statement that Dr. Kentley made. Learn and get all that you can get now, because you're going to need it. Now, I don't know what that needed really is, but I believe what he said. And that has become part of what I want to indulge in. Yes, the world got a lot to offer. It does. But now I'm starting to look at the things that I do. What are they telling me about Yahshua? How are they pointing out what I should be looking at instead of looking at the physical, like Marlon was saying? Quit looking at the thing and look at, you know, what do you have on your mind about the thing? We have a lot that we to eat. And this is some good food. And the only I've come to know, my only salvation, it is not. I know I'm talking about on a daily basis. It's not up to me. It's not up to me. My focus is what can I learn about my Savior. And when in doing that, it gives me comfort. It takes down those raging idiots, which are thoughts. Put my mind on something of much value, or to say, who's controlling the idiots? And I can't go wrong. I can't go wrong. So, like I said, I've been inspired to read. And I'm not going to get off into, you know, like, I need to do this, I need to study, I need to, No. Mm-mm. It don't work that way. It does not. When it is time, I have those thoughts. I watch my manifestations around me. And let me tell you, it seems like there's so many that comes in to want to take me away from what I want to learn and understand, or just even read to know about Yahshua and what he did. So many of those things. See, now I have to discipline myself and have, just move it out the way. You know, it comes to me because I'm a busybody, okay? It takes too much of my time, and when I start to realize the things that I can get busy in, it's not worth it. It really isn't worth it. Then I'll stand around and say, oh, wow, I didn't get a chance. Whose fault is that? You know, so I have to take everything and put it on myself, because Yahweh so loved me that he's given me some tools. Now I need to learn how to use those tools. And as long as I've been in class, I looked at myself, you should have known that already. Because it's not me teaching me. It's not me learning. But I have to know too, to put forth, you know, like, it's like a kid. A kid wants something, well, you know, hey, you go out there and mow the lawn, you can get paid. You give you some kind of, you know, a parent is not just going to give out, well, some of them, okay. Just give, and the kid don't know how they got it. They can't appreciate what they got, because they don't, oh, like money is on the trees. Well, okay, mom and daddy, they're men walking as trees. money from mom and daddy. So going through having to learn, having to research, and to understand the principles always is going to be there. And always keep in mind to look for those. You know, so I thank Yahweh for allowing me the time. And this scripture, yeah, 2 Corinthians. Just pick it up, 3, 4, well, beginning.
2 Corinthians 3 and 4. Sorry. Mm-hmm. 2 Corinthians 4 and 3. But if our evangel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost.
Okay, that is so true. Because if you don't have the pattern, if you don't first get the name straight, knowing the name, how the name, title, and where that Yahweh manifested in the flesh. It's not a Jesus that was here and he's gone and he's coming back. See, this gospel is here to those people that are endowed with waiting for Jesus to come back. And it is by grace that Yahweh has given us the key and has shown us how he himself took on this shape and form that is pure spirit, inscrutable, incomprehensible. And with Elohim, his son, the super incorporeal shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood, 9 divine attributes. How many people in the churches has ever heard that even Jesus had any type of attributes? Oh yeah, God is love. God is love. And I guess he's patient and merciful. You know, the things that when we get really all hard up and in trouble or something bugging, those are the ones that we look for. We, you know, what about the foundation that we supposed to be standing on? And the strength, you know, what about those? So it is a mystery that has been unlocked, unfold to us in our day. And it is real. It is real. Go ahead.
In whom the spirit of this age hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious evangel of the Messiah, who is the image of Yahweh, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but the Messiah, Yahshua, the Savior, and ourselves your servants for Yahshua's sake.
That's right. And that is what we are. This is what I'm coming into an understanding. It's like one of the scriptures say, what manner of persons ought ye to be, seeing that you have the truth? There is a way. You know, Yahshua in you, that consciousness or awareness of what this is all entail for us to learn about him. We're not here for a grand tour. We're not here to please. More than likely, we're going to end up offending, being hated. And to understand and know that, and why, for the Messiah's sake, your soul's salvation, one who have saved you for his sake, if I can put it like that. That's why these things must be. And to letting us know when they do come about. This is believing the report. So when it does happen, okay, I've already been told. So I'm going to stop right there. I thank Yahweh dearly, you know, for all of us being here. And I just hope and pray that he continue to allow us to keep our focus on him in the simplest manner for me. I don't need to know all the the ins and outs and everything about, just give me what you have already, the simplicity, and let me accept the way that you have placed the truth in me, that I may be able to deliver to whomever your word, not mine. So with that, I'm going to say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Oh, good morning. Good morning. Well, 3 months ago, the 13, I went to the hospital. You don't know, you know now. I have a small stroke and I barely started learning how to walk. Because I cannot even walk when I was in the hospital. Little by little, I started picking up again. And well, everything is working fine. My memory is, well, it's all age is going a little bit. But the scripture we have today is 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, the 18th verse. Can you read that, Eunice, please?
18?
Yeah, it's the last one.
Right. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal.
Thank you very much. See, we are in the Institute of Divine Metaphysics Research, beyond the physical. So everything is spiritual. Even if we have the charts and we are pointing to certain things, but you just translate those things, those are spiritual things. And let's see if I can, where is the stick? Okay. If I move slow, excuse me, it's, yeah, it's, the scripture today is a really, really good one. It's the whole thing, but this particular verse is keep the eye on me. See, we see, thank you. We see in this chart, it's been called the Exodus chart. This is the second one, was made. And in this picture, we have the tabernacle in the middle. And we know already, because we keep coming and learning about Moses and Pharaoh, how he went out of Egypt and returned when he was 80 and delivered the people he was told to do so. And he made 3 trips to the mountain. One, he went to the plateau. That's the first one. The second one, he was in the cloud. You see how everything was created by Elohim. Yahweh, pure spirit, is, you can see over here, all the attributes which are the most important, the nine, the most important attributes of man. So those attributes transform into Elohim, which is the son of Yahweh. After that, Yahweh no have nothing to do. All the jobs was doing by Elohim. Who is Elohim? Elohim is Yahweh, Elohim in Yahshua. It's the same thing. One, two, three. Everything in the universe is one, two, three. No matter what subject you talk about, is one, two, three. The tabernacle. The tabernacle was in the cloud. It was right there. Impossible to see because nobody see the Father. But it was there. And it transformed Elohim, transformed into threefold unchangeable sanctuary. And everything is made according to one, two, three. Most holy place, and Quran about. One, two, three. Everything exists in the universe is one, two, three. The cell and the atom. You just name it. One, two, three. And the furniture in this tabernacle are nine principles. Same as the nine principles, attributes of Yahweh. See, Yahweh Elohim, he transformed into the tabernacle. And later on, 1490 years before Yahshua the Messiah, he gave a specification how to build this tabernacle. Because Moses, he was a goodly child when he was a little boy. He was chosen by Yahweh. He can choose anyone, but he chose him. Moses. He have a job for him. And he did so very well. He take the children out of Egypt, but we can see like he did it, but he did not. His minister is the one. Ochia, the son of Nun, which later on Moses changed his name into Yahshua. Later on. And he's the one did all the job. See, from the beginning of the creation, he's been with us all this time. And most of us, we miss him. But he's been with us all the time. Good or bad, he's there. It's not as matter. He's there. And he told how to build three special things with a divine specifications. One was Noah's Ark, which we have in this chart, and you can see in the flood is 1, 2, 3. Low deck, middle deck, and upper deck. 1, 2, 3. Same is the tabernacle. Quran about most holy place and holy place. 1, 2, 3. The cell and the atom. I already mentioned that. And the other thing, it was given this dimension, specified dimensions, was Solomon Temple. Only three things. Noah's Ark, the Tabernacle, and Solomon Temple. Some people say, oh, God told me to build this church for him. It's not so. It's a lie. They only have in their mind they want to do. And yes, ask for a little cooperation and money to build something. They probably spend most of the money in the building, but I believe they probably keep some for them. Oh, this is life, you know. Well, I'm going to use the chart over there. See, I'm going to paint something over here. When I say Yahweh told Moses to build the tabernacle, he built the tabernacle. 1, 2, 3. But see, this is not the way it was. In reality, this is the way it was. Close by, not exactly, but close to. There. Here was 100 cubits equal to 150 feet. Right. Here is a typical 50 cubits equal to 75 feet. This tabernacle is most holy place and holy place. Oh, this is wrong. The holy place is smaller than the most holy place. This is 20 cubits by 10 cubits equal to 30 and equal to 15. See, this is the way the tabernacle looks like. It's close to. No, not exactly. And the nine principles furnitures, they were made of brass and gold. The ones in the corner about was brass. And the ones in the most holy place and holy place, they were gold. See, they have a the Ark of the Covenant. Have two rings, one here and the other one the other side, and they put a staff in there. That way they can carry it because nobody can touch it.
Right.
Whoever touches it pass away, right away. See, this was 2.5 long, 1.5 wide, and 1.5 high. That's the dimensions. Now, the dimensions of the altar of incense, it was a longer one. It had 4 horns, one on each corner. When the high priest made the sacrifice, he put the blood in the horns. And to roast something had to be like this. And it was continuously burning. All the time was fire on there. That's was five. Why and five. And 3 high cubits equal to 7.5 feet, 4.5 wide. And also de altar the table where the high priest put the 12 loaves of bread. Six on one side and six in the other one, plus the pitcher and the cups of gold. Everything was gold. This table was made from acacia, covered with gold. So is the altar, and so is the covenant. They were acacia wood covered by gold. So is the staff. They were of wood covered by gold. That's why they were very strong. And the candle of seven branches. That was made from one piece of gold with a hammer. One talent equal to 30 kilos or 75 pounds of gold. And they were equal. See, this was, they put the oil in here, and they fill it up in the same time. They fill it up with the oil, and the oil went up, and they put fire in the night. 9 o'clock in the morning, they turn it off because the door was facing to east, and the sun used to go inside. That's why they had to put the candlestick off during the day. The table was here. And the brazen altar in front of the door. And they have also a censer, the altar of incense. It was on top 1 foot square. 1 foot this way and 1 foot this way. Equal to 1.5 feet. Or 1 cubit. 5 sides. 1, 2, 3, 4. How you explain the 5? One, two, three, four, five. The high priest used to put right here the incense stuff. 5 sides. Or if I put it different way, let me make another picture. See, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 size incense. It was 1 by 1 by 2. 2 cubits high. Well, these specifications are not told very often, so I just want to let you know. I have a memory. I cannot write the same way I used to. But anyway, you can understand my pictures. Well, I started a little green, a little tired. Thank you very much for your attention. Have a nice day.
And for our next speaker will be our dean, Dr. Marlon Love.
Good afternoon, class. I get excited sometimes because I really enjoy class today. Thoroughly enjoyed everybody and their testimonies and what was expressed through the lecture. Happy to see you get up, Doc, and share what you know about the tabernacle and the things that we endeavor to know and learn, because it's the knowledge about Yahshua Messiah who is invisible, right? Super incorporeal being that came down in the likeness of sinful flesh. And we come to learn about this in order to have some salvation from that which we have become. Grab the textbook and I want to look up a definition. A lot of things were said today, and I'm not sure of how to go about really going into it, but we're going to start with something out of the textbook, and I'll try not to get excited for the little one. the word I want to get up is carnal.
Carnal, of the flesh.
Of the flesh. Now, previous speaker talked about a body. And we need to make clear what body we're talking about. Because everything is created by Elohim. Doc said that when Yahweh created Elohim, that Yahweh went out of the creating business. And he created everything from the creation, from out of pure spirit, right? And therefore, that body that we are moving around and dealing with, we need to make clear what body that we're expressing. When we're looking at spiritual things, that body that we're walking around in, that we see in entertainment and any other kind of shape, fashion, or form through media, through TV, is not the body that we're talking about. That needs to be explicitly clear that your aches and pains is not the body, is not the problem. Recarnal is flesh, and we immediately think that we're talking about a body. And that's not the body or the fleshly that we're talking about. Read.
Material or worldly.
Material or worldly. Remember, pure spirit materialized. Why? So that we can have something to see, touch, sound, taste, and smell. Those elements that we smell, fragrances, that's material. In a form, molecules whereby we can determine what smells bad and what smells good, right? That's material that was created from out of pure spirit, because you can't see, touch, taste, or smell pure spirit, but yet that's the spirituality that we're coming into a consciousness of. Not what we feel we like and what we think we want, not that. So keep reading.
Not spiritual, sensual.
Not spiritual. Not spiritual. So that body that we have is not a spiritual body. That flesh and blood that we're dealing with is not spiritual. It's just a spirit made flesh in a form called a body, because remember, in this school, we have to keep in mind that we use analogies, metaphors, similes, in various ways in order to come about to an understanding about pure spirit. It's not literal. It's a conscious state. Now, that's carnal. That says carnal is not spiritual.
Right.
But yet we have, just grab the definition right there in the book, a spirit. Mm-hmm. Spirit is material. The worldly or physical things is spirit materialized. Right? I mean, we're trying to find that body, make clear of what that body is.
Spirit, the life principle.
The life principle.
Especially in man.
Especially in man.
Yahweh.
Comma, Yahweh. So there's something in the man that's the spirit. And what we've come and what Doc Reiser had made mention when Doc had his vision and divine revelation, he was asked, what are you going to do with it, man, of that which I've given to you? Asked it three times, if I recollect correctly. And he said that he didn't even answer. He said that the spirit got into him and answered him that on his own question. Mm-hmm. Doc Kenny didn't have nothing to do with it, as it's been expressed, and you can read it as such, that he didn't answer the question that he's going to teach his people. He said that the spirit of Yahshua the Messiah got into him, and he answered the question, and that was to teach his people about spirit, using the physical material things on earth. And as I read in Genesis 2, that it was good and very good.
Right.
Then where do you get off coming? I'm talking about the bodies this and the things is that. If it's good and very good,
right.
The material things, what we think is body, what we think and we see, touch, say, sound, smell, has a problem. Keep her in there. Life source is the spirit, because if you don't have a spirit in you, you don't have a source in you to walk around, to smell, to touch, to taste, to sound. So what is the principle?
The ultimate source.
The ultimate source. The principle is the ultimate source.
Origin?
It's the origin. It's the start. Read.
Or cause of something.
Or the cause of something. That's not spirit. I mean, spirit don't have that definition, is what I'm expressing. But he said the ultimate source of life is principle. Read.
A fundamental truth.
A fundamental factual truth. That's gained by knowledge. Not a doing something. Because we don't have known what we've been doing from Jump Street. Keep reading.
Law.
It's a law. Not a physical carnal law, but yet it's still it's a law. Read.
Doctrine.
It's a doctrine. It's a gospel. This is principle. You still in principle?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And it's the ultimate life source. Keep reading.
The law of the spirit by which all things operate.
Ha! All things operate by the law of the spirit. Not the body.
Right.
Not the flesh. Not what you see, touch, taste, sound, smell, and assume, which is your opinion, which is your concept, which is your theory, right. Which is your moral dignity, which is your corruptible ways, which is your temporal ways, your morals.
That's right.
Those are all thoughts. Mm-hmm. They are not physical. They're necessary.
Right.
Certainly necessary. Because mm-hmm. Some of us, if we didn't have any foundation and just didn't have no morals, it would be even a more hellacious place. for they're relevant, just as the relevancy of this chart. Anything more on principles there before I go on?
No, that was it.
That was it. Mm-hmm. But it's a doctrine. Mm-hmm. And when you have a doctrine, you got to learn something through a doctrine. And so we have this mosaic chart, which I believe was the second chart that was created after this elementary chart that Doc had sanctioned to be drawn up as a tool. Nothing holy about it in that fashion. You follow? But this tool, Dr. Gross, the president, often made reference that this tool or this chart takes your picture. This chart takes your picture. Now, you ask that to anybody else they've never seen this chart, they've also said it looks like a chart of scrambled eggs. So therefore, if it looks like scrambled eggs and you can't, when you scramble an egg, you can't tell a white, you can't tell the yolk, it's all together. You got Moses, you got John, you got this transfiguration in the mount, you got a tabernacle, you got this golden calf. This thing's all over this chart. How's it relevant? How's it taking my picture? Eunice expressed it that you got to begin with Moses. You have to understand what was provided us in order to get us to a point in order to perceive what this at its face value to a new person may not be high nor hair of anything relevant for your principal soul salvation. Grab soul real quick, because we have a spirit. Every man is given a certain sufficient amount of intelligence to comprehend spirit. But yet there's something inside of that body, this flesh. This is going to be the body. Not this body, not what we see, touch, but this soul. This is a body. Read.
Soul, the immortal or spiritual part of a person.
The immortal spiritual part of a person is housed inside of this vessel, this mortal vessel, is mortal, subject to corruption. Just naturally so, old age come about, you're going to kick the bucket. And we all attend to that, but yet we all want salvation of some fashion. But the body is not being, the vessel, the mortal vessel is not being saved. Right. It's this soul that's housed inside, and that's the corruptible body that we read about in 2 Corinthians. Keep reading soul.
That was it. Yep.
So we got to look at this immortal spiritual body that's going to cross over, because the flesh is going to go bye-bye. And then you're going to have a body, which is your soul, in the next age, and it's going to learn without the body. So we have to get it now so that we have some stability in this fifth age, seventh dispensation, if you want to call it. But it's going to be without this physical body. And the love that I am coming into awareness of is to be able to convey that to another person that think that their soul is irrelevant. Think that they're just toiling around in a vessel and that means something. How do you convey it? And that which Dr. Guinea gave to us is a not even miraculous, it is universal, and it's a reconciliation unto our soul. The gospel, which is a principle that we read, it's a factual thing. These events are not fables or some happenstance story that we're just reading about. When you understand the spiritual principle, Isaiah 28, 9, and 10 talks about these principles, right? Precept.
Right.
It's a principle. And there's a line of this principle that runs a bloodline that was touched on briefly. There's a water line in every one of these events. Here, down here, there's a principle water line all the way down. There's a principle water line in our lives today. This is why this chart taking your picture. Because when we can see how the death principle or the blood principle, the blood being that blood that they had to put on this door, you see, on the two side posts across the mantle, and they differ from the basin. That's a blood principle. And every door that did not have that, there was going to be a firstborn going to be dead with that death angel that came, right? And see, that death angel, he's going to look on that soul or that inner man within us of what we're going to have to consume, which is the knowledge. That's all Yahshua was. He's spirit in the likeness of sin, in the he was not flesh. He was in the likeness of sinful flesh. That's why everybody got hung up. And we wear crosses now. And they're trying to do something. And they're waiting back. They're waiting for a body to return. But he said never no more to return. He said he passed out his Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. Whereby we become the first fruits in this age in time. Yahshua being the first fruits in that age of time. Because Eunice expressed that we have to rightly divide the word of truth. The truth is what we can see, touch, sound, smell in a way to perceive spirit. It had to be, it's real, it's true. Death is a reality. But yet, how we look at that or how we look at things, that's even a more super reality, if I can say it like that, whereby we endeavor to see and understand. Because remember, the first dispensation, second dispensation, and that flood, and what's so special about these dispensations? Can anybody maybe express real quick one or two words of what these dispensations is different than these other ones? Remember him on this mountain? Meaning, remember Moses on this mountain? What do you see? Yeah? That's how the world came in chaotic. He saw the waters divide. He saw the 6 days and the 7 day creation, right? This is on the second trip. And on that second trip, the next 33 days, we expressed he saw this incorporeal tabernacle pattern that Doc made mention of, right? That Elohim transformed into. And that every cosmographical material thing is derived in pattern after this threefold tabernacle pattern. But then we're on the third trip. Remember? He had a recompilation of the genealogies from Adam all the way back down to that point of the Holy Spirit. He saw the transition. In a vision. Right. In a vision we have in that. Until he shown it at the burning bush. And Yahweh began to reveal to man. They didn't reveal his name back here at Adam. Mm-hmm. He didn't reveal it with Noah.
Right.
Didn't have no conscience of it. But this was a vision given to us by the hands or in the inspired writings of Moses. Based off a vision that he saw directly from Yahweh. Mm-hmm. He's here in the fourth dispensation. And it's significant because when we understand how these charts or these tools work, you won't get lost in translation or false doctrine. Because you understand that this fourth dispensation is synonymous to this fourth day of the creation.
Right.
It's synonymous to this candlestick that Doc drew on this four. Don't think this is just nothing.
That's right.
You know, there's certain things you have to understand how things are placed in here. And if you've been here in the amount of time, you understand that he's talking about these furnaces, this light, and this table of shewbread, and this laver, right? It was inside of this box. Just so we got it clear, just so we make clear. Because he drew it right. He drew the one like we have here, which you can kind of still see, because it don't go all the way around. But don't be mindful that these vessels of gold, the laver, the shewbread, and the candlestick, were in the holy place, you see. And in understanding why gold here and why this is a three-in-one configuration, this Ark of a Covenant with the two archangels on the mercy seat, right? It's synonymous of these nine principal attributes that we do have, that we have been shown, that are the divine reigning principles in print, the nine primary principles, principle, just like that principle that we read there in that definition of principle. And so we got to pull the principles out. That's why when we go over these dimensions and understand how and why they're structured in the way that he's expressed those, they become very powerful in your root foundation, in the jots, in the tittles, if you would. Huh? And that's what gives us our more stability in the ability to see how this tabernacle was created, so that we can see how man was made in the image of Elohim by the pattern of the tabernacle, right? It's by a pattern, it's a principle pattern that fits all things, even ourselves. And therefore, we become humbled unto what? Knowledge. And it's that knowledge that's going to carry. Now, the understanding of it is when it gets into your soul. It's not just it's not topical. It's got to get into you, because a lot of people can come and run blood, water, spirit, 40, ascension, and run all around. But when it's I remember a class, Dr. Volpe expressed how this is altar of sin sacrifice. No, this is the altar of incense, correct? And they had four primary ingredients in order to make this incense put off a sweet-smelling savor unto Yahweh, because this is Yahweh's dwelling place. This is in darkness up here. Remember, no one able to get up here except for one time a year, three times within one day. Day of Atonement, right? And so now, all the other while, but when he, the high priest, when he come up here, you see him holding this, the censer, right? He was enshrouded with that censer. I mean, that smoke permeated his clothing. You know how you guys smoke a cigarette or something, you can smell them after they done put it out, and they come back in and thinking they done covered up, and you smell them. Because it's in their clothes, you got a smoker in the house, you know, used to be, and then you get smell, and you're like, ugh, right? But that's an understanding, because it's a type of how that high priest was infused with that smoke in order to go up in here and to function the way he had to function around this Ark of the Covenant, always having to face this Ark of the Covenant and not touch the Ark of the Covenant, like Doc said. Not even the high priest can touch it, because when he went into that most holy place, he went in between these staffs. Am I correct, Doc? And then he had to throw that blood seven times while he walked around. Never turn your back on Yahweh. See, this Ark of the Covenant, you can put even two archangels up here. I'm not pretty at drawing. But you got two archangels, if you would, right? Whatever. Right? And they were close right here, you see? But these archangels, they were looking down, right? They weren't looking at one another. They're looking down at the cloud that's set in between these two archangels, right? Just as our mind, we have a right and left hemisphere, right? And it's like into a cloudy like substance. And so you hear, you have that cloud here, and these archangels are looking at this eye, that one all-seeing eye, which is Yahweh. You see, and this ingredients is like in the four main ingredients in the air that we breathe. And we better not do without one of them ingredients. And we live and dwell within that oxygenated air, correct? It's outside of us and it's in us. That's a type and a shadow or a principle how Yahweh has never left his creation. And this is how we understand how Yahweh from the beginning ordained that Adam was not going to be deceived. You got a whole world thinking that there was a mess up. It was a problem. It's flesh. It was an understanding. It came from out of eternity. It was designed for this because what died was the conscience. Romans 8 and 20, please. That's the body that died. Adam lived to be 930 years old. The body did, the vessel, the mortality of Adam in all his glory lived to be 930. But what died was his conscience. That was what left that state of perfection, if you would, of knowing who Elohim was. Right. But he broke a law, a covenant, by purpose, because right. He had already ushered all this in to be. And now if you're going to have an open heart and an open mind in order to understand how the gospel, that's a principle or a doctrine.
Right.
That's what's in the principle of that principle definition we read. If you're going to believe the report, which is a doctrine, which is a gospel, this is what we're expressing. There's no accident up here. There was no choice of Adam and Eve up here. It was by design,
that's right,
specifically for the sons of Yahweh today to be able to perceive and see and understand what? Read. This is what we got. This is what we got to understand about this event. Not bellyaching about it, but understanding what the gospels say. Read.
Romans.
This is Romans. This is the epistle of Saul to the Romans. Read.
8:20.
Mm-hmm.
For the creature was made subject to vanity.
The creature was made. Wasn't Adam made in the garden and placed in the garden? He was made outside the garden and placed in the garden because, you see.
Right.
Oh, man, 8 and 28, we ain't got time. Keep going.
Not willingly, but by reason of him who had subjected the same.
Him is Yahshua. Him is Yahweh. Him is the one that created all things.
Right.
He subjected. Just as Eunice said, we've all been subjected into our ways. And unless we have an open heart and open mind to see the way of Yahweh,
right,
the purpose, pattern, and plan that he's ordained within us, not just knowing about it, but embracing the knowledge of Yahweh in order to do what? Read.
Because the creature itself was also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption and to the glorious liberty of the children of Yahweh.
You're going
to
have that bondage. Is 8 and 23 maybe? Keep going. So you're gonna, but even though you were created, and we all were created out of our mother's womb, we all come the way, one way, and we all didn't come. We have all come not in the way of Adam. I used to think like this. I tell on myself. Adam and Eve partook of that olive fruit, if you call it. And their consciousness was lost. And in that state of mind that they had in this age of conscience, and it carried over to Noah. In the 8, when they landed there on Mount Ararat, right? And then what has been expressed is that those satanic beings got back into the population at that time, right? And they died in Adam. Follow me. They died in Adam. And they carried on through that because that water can't swallow up spirit.
Right.
The bodies was laying out. That's why he sent the raven out first. Mm-hmm. You follow?
Right.
And because the raven was feeding on the flesh.
Right.
Raven is like unto Pharaoh, or the bad guy, if you would. Or those thoughts that are wicked continuously. That's what the raven's representing. But that dove, it brought back an olive branch.
Right.
You see, an olive branch of forgiveness. Just as we just read there, that creature is going to be able to be saved in the righteousness, which is by way of that dove, is what it's representing, the principle of the righteousness, in order for them to come up out of that ark at the appointed time. But over time, that spirit crept in to the men and to the families of that time. Then you got the Nimrod, then created. You got those that still did not know Yahweh. They knew El Shaddai. They knew that there was a provider for them, right? And so what happens is what? Abraham was given a promise, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Given a promise that through his seed, singular, that all the nations, right,
mm-hmm.
were going to be saved by him, right? So now, Yahweh come in, right? As Eunice expressed, you were given the law or given a promise here, right? And that they had to go down to a land and be evilly entreated for some 400 years, right? And but as we may mention that Joseph came down here, he was in a likeness of Elohim, already ready to receive, just as our Father is ready to receive us once we believe, you see? And see, when those 11 other brothers came down and they saw, there was love there. They knew in their consciousness something they saw the error of their ways, if you would. And see, so and with that you have the purpose coming up, and whereby that after that 400 years you have Joshua leading the way by the cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night, as it was expressed, right? And all these symbolics and all these events down here are pointing to something, because this is the institution of way to come to know Yahweh Elohim, right? And so when they come out here, what you have is a law given, a carnal law. This is how Yahweh set up the purpose for man to be able to know. Now, it was this law that was given to the Jews and the Jews only. You have nothing about a sin until this law was imposed on them. Where's your sin at? When did that sin that you sinned come to be? If we're going to believe the report that this law, Ten Commandments or 613 judgments, statutes, ordinances, was to the Jews and the Jews only. And if this was dedicated a sin, because if they committed a sin, they had to bring a sacrifice. When's the last time you knew anybody in your family brought a sacrifice to anything in order to be redeemed of a sin? So that sin, what? It was abolished.
Mm-hmm.
Some 1490 years later, as Doc May mentioned, because this was put on them. And now we're coming into an understanding now that when Yahshua Messiah came, and when he was baptized of John, and he said he come to fulfill what? Sin that he's instituted on them. So the question is, my question was, I'm still in sin. Well, if he said he coming to fulfill, and they still thinking that he's coming and he ain't fulfilled or finished anything, where's it? And if I'm not a Jew, what sin have I committed? The only sin I was expressed at the time, not knowing who Yahshua the Messiah was. That's the problem. It's not a sin. There's a gulf of that soul or that body that needs to be changed. That's all. Of subjecting yourself to the truth, to the principle that the gospel is representing. That takes the burden and the struggle off of do this or do that. If that's not your call, you do what thus said Yahshua the Messiah say do. Grab me Exodus. You didn't find there in Romans, huh? 8 and 23, that the law was carnally death. Carnally minded is death, is what I wanted.
6.
Okay, sorry.
For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh.
Now look. You're after the flesh. Adam died in his consciousness. And those things that are after the flesh or the worldly things, I think I had carnal red,
right,
which is bodily, which is worldly,
yeah,
which is according to your imagination about the thing.
Right.
Because that's the flesh, that's the body that don't know Yahweh.
Right.
Keep reading.
But they that are after the spirit, the things of the spirit.
Uh-huh. Now you got to be after the spirit. This whole time is together. But this law of sin of sacrifices, that was fulfilled. Mm-hmm. That's not a sin you've never incurred before. Mm-hmm. Ever. But what we have incurred was a dead state of thinking about
right.
that which we know not.
That's right.
And what does it say?
Mm-hmm. For to be carnally minded is death.
Is death. You not have a sinning problem. You have a dead state.
That's
it's
right.
dead understanding about your creator. Yeah. That's not a sin of do's and don'ts. You have a dead understanding about Yahshua the Messiah. That's what we need to embrace.
That's right.
This is why this last hour, Doc said, learn all you need to learn. Mm-hmm. Because it's why that's going to help you. Keep reading.
Right. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace.
That's what we endeavor to want to get. What you going to do to go and do good to please Yahweh? Nothing. Well, so what you done sin? Only thing you done did not know Yahshua.
That's it.
And he said, learn of me, because my burden is light.
Yep.
Right? Exodus 17 and 1.
Exodus 17 and 1.
Now, we talked about earlier about learning, about why this gospel, as it said in the was a principle or a doctrine, was a thing of principle. A doctrine was. Now we're reading Exodus. To the law and to the prophets, right? We're back in Exodus under the law of Moses talking about something. Let's read.
And all the congregation of the children of Israel.
Of Israel, not the Gentiles. Of Israel, and they didn't know what a sin was at that time. Read.
Journeyed from the wilderness of Sin after their journey.
And that a queen could think. Keep going.
According to the commandment of Yahweh.
According to a commandment to Yahweh. That means they ain't just going willy-nilly how they want to go. It's a commandment of Yahweh. They went from the land of sin over to where? Keep reading.
And pitched in Rephidim, and there was no water for the people.
There was no water. You understand metaphors? That water is the gospel.
Right.
They had nothing to drink.
Right.
See, for us today, the preaching of the gospel is the water, is the living water of Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
They didn't have it. And how they act? Keep reading.
Wherefore the people did contend with Moses.
They had a problem with Moses, the physical man, as though he had brought them up out of the land of Egypt, and they knew not Joshua the Messiah. Read.
And said, give us water that we may drink.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses said unto them, why contend with me?
Yeah.
Wherefore do ye tempt Yahweh?
Tempt. We do that. Not knowing Yahweh and the power that be. But keep reading.
And the people thirsted there for water.
Hungry.
And the people murmured against Moses and said, wherefore is that thou hast brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our cattle with thirst?
Oh, my goodness. Hey, this is how that takes a picture, because everybody smile and know that we bellyache the same way, wanting water.
That's right.
We didn't have been given the water all around us, but do we learn of it and partake of it and use it when it is in this apropos? Yeah, there's learning curves. But be thankful for it, because that's the true gospel. That's the true water that they were yearning for way back when. That's why we keep rehearsing it, whereby you can draw that principle water out. Because it's by a gospel of a pure river of running water that we're going to be able to behold and see and understand according to our true conscience, our true understanding, our transformation of that wicked soul within us that knew not Yahweh. And I only say wicked soul, I want to say an unaware soul about Yahshua the Messiah, because as it was expressed, we all were put in that situation. So you're not wicked, as wicked would be. It's whether Yahweh give you the desire to seek him while he yet may be found. Skip on down to, I'm done, I'm almost done. Skip on down to when Yahshua, after they fought the Amalek.
And Joshua discomfited?
Okay. Then we had them belly aching, and they went to war with Amalek. Read.
And then came Amalek and fought with Israel.
That's
and
right. And remember, Israel ain't fighting nothing. It was Joshua the Messiah fighting for on behalf of them. But we learn that later on. This is a confidence that we stand on. Yahshua's fighting for us now if we believe the report. Keep reading.
And Moses said unto Joshua, choose us out men and go out fight with Amalek.
Okay.
Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod.
So what you got a problem is that Moses got to hold up his hand. He didn't have it, but he had to sit on the stone in order to keep his hand up. You see, you had that stone that went with them from up out of the land of Egypt. And this is why they're fighting now with the Amalek. But he's sitting like unto a throne with his hands up. He's like up here in this archangel. See, holding his hands up, his two hands over, sitting on that mercy seat or that stone that was in the Ark of the Covenant. Wasn't that a stone, the Ten Commandments stone? That was already they ain't had them yet, but it was already a witness, as that song we had earlier today. Everything points to Yahshua the Messiah. Keep reading on down. Real quick.
So Joshua did as Moses had said to him and fought with Amalek.
Yeah.
And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill.
Get on down there further when after he finished him. Finished beating. They annihilated Amalek. Those are all our problems. 13.
And Joshua discomfited Amalek.
Discomfited. Destroyed Amalek. Joshua did that, not Moses. That's Joshua or Yahshua the Messiah that's going to defeat them back here, because I'm Yahweh and I change not. That was Yahshua the Messiah that destroyed and fought all their battles. So you ain't fighting nothing against the flesh. You can't win against the flesh. It is Yahshua the Messiah that's going to fight for you. Why? Keep reading.
And his people with the edge of the sword.
That's the sword is the gospel that's going to cut both ways. And like a tiny thunder of the moral and the bone. It is the moral inside the bone that has the emphasis, that has the nutrients. That's where that blood is dwelling. The blood ain't dwelling in the bones, not in the bones. That's the moral. That's where the blood, that's the understanding of Yahshua Messiah in your bones, right? That's that moral. That's what the gospel does. That's what the gospel cuts out, the egotistical, misdirected personality. Keep reading.
And Yahweh said unto Moses.
Yahweh saying this, read.
Write this for a memorial
in a book.
And rehearse it in the ears of Joshua.
Mm-hmm.
For I will utterly put out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven.
Under heaven, under your state of mind, and under your speaking. When you see the book, that book of life that Elohim holds for each and every one that believes in the gospel and Yahshua the Messiah by way of or Yahweh Elohim, by way of Yahshua Messiah. If you got anything out of today's class, all praises to Yahweh our Elohim, by way of Yahshua the Messiah, let us all say, Hallelujah.
Okay, thank you, everyone, for coming out and studying with us. We hold classes here every Tuesday and Thursday from 7:30 to 9:30. Sundays, every Sunday to 11 to 1. Let us all stand to be dismissed.
I'll be reading the doxology out of Jude, the last two verses. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah.